creature could amount to your desire. You're the one who ever leaves the one behind.
James chapter 3, verses 1 through 12, taming the tongue. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a fire is set ablaze by a small fire. The tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring forth the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray together.
Father, we are thankful. We are thankful that you speak. We are thankful that you are here for us, to walk with us. So God, now we pray that you open our ears, open our hearts, that we might hear you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. I love that song Sarah picked for this morning. It fits very well with James chapter 3. I think you'll soon see why. I'm going to start by actually reading in Genesis chapter 1. Hear the word of God. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was formless and void. Excuse me. The earth was formless and void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Then God said, and it was so. That's how God created the heavens and the earth. Speech, the power of the tongue, the world-making potential of a spoken word. And every word that comes from the mouth of God is like this Genesis passage. It brings life into existence. It makes gospel our everyday reality. You know, in fact, the word of God is so life-giving that John's gospel actually speaks of Jesus, God incarnate, as the living word of God. Here's another familiar passage for us from John chapter 1, the first five verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him. That is the word of God, the speech of God. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. When God speaks, life happens. When God speaks, the gospel comes into existence. When God speaks, healing breaks out. So when we speak, why do we expect anything less of ourselves? In the beginning, at the start of time, before the earth ever knew death, before us humans ever knew decay of any kind, God planted a garden, Garden of Eden, all with that life-giving power of a single word. And in that garden, God formed us humans from simple dust and breathed into us, into our deepest being, the breath of life, all with a single word. And God called us to a task, a familiar task from Genesis 1:26. Reflect the image of God. Be fruitful. Multiply. Fill the earth with the knowledge of the glory of God. And in that garden, God did a marvelous thing that's a little bit easier to miss, a little bit less familiar. God gave us humans the ability to name every creature with a word. This is Genesis 2, verse 19. So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. Whatever humans called these creatures, that's what they were, naming their identity. Speech, the power of the tongue, a world-making potential of a spoken word. God gave us humans that exact same ability. It's right there in Genesis 2:19. Put that same world-shaping potential in our very own lips. We are made in the image of God. And that's why the perfect human, Jesus Christ, is called the living Word of God. We humans were made to be a living Word of God in the earth. So what went wrong? Taming the tongue, something the Apostle James calls an impossible task. In fact, in James 3, verses 7 through 8, he writes these words, every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species, but no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. And you know, we know exactly what James means, don't we? We know all too well the vicious power of the tongue. You know, as kids, we riddled to ourselves, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. And yet then we grew up and became adults. We found out that words cut far deeper than stones and sticks ever could. Because words cut to the heart. You know, we know exactly what James is getting at in this passage of Scripture. Those creation days of a world where words have life-giving potential, they often feel like a bygone memory. And this is so relevant to our daily lives. I know each and every one of us have felt the painful sting of a misplaced word. But probably more poignant, each and every one of us have also been the ones to dish it out. James 3, verse 2. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistake in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. You know, I try to imagine the weight of these words from James as if we sat in the room of people who first read the apostle's letter. I love trying to imagine these letters that way. I mean, after all, in the opening of the letter, James addresses the letter to the 12 tribes of the dispersion. In other words, James is writing to the people of God who are dispersed, people of God who are persecuted, people of God who are far from home, who perhaps are hungry, tired, frustrated, maybe a bit angry at their situation. In fact, we talked a couple weeks ago about how James starts his letter. He starts with a word of encouragement for those who are suffering, encouragement for perseverance even amid struggle upon struggle. Now let me ask this. When do we find it most difficult to speak words of life instead of words of death? Is it when we're comfortable, when we have enough to eat, when everything's going our way? No! It's when we're hungry, when we're tired, when we're frustrated at the end of a long day, perhaps quite like James's first readers. You know, in fact, we've even made a new word to describe how whiny we get when we're hungry. Hangry. Have anybody heard the word hangry? Right? Hungry and angry all together. Hangry, right? And the culture's almost okay with this. There's this commercial, I'm sure you've seen it, where somebody who's speaking negative words over and over again, finally their friend comes up and says, "You're not yourself when you're hungry," and hands them a Snickers bar, right? The culture's almost okay with this hangry idea, as if it's okay to speak negatively when the pressure of life sets in. You see, that's exactly the truth. As soon as the pressure of life gets real, that's when the true state of our heart is often made evident by the words we say. As soon as the pressure gets real, that's when the true state of our heart is often made evident by the words that we say. When friends stand against us, how often do we turn to gossip? When coworkers or employers challenge us, how often do we speak harsh words that we never say to their face? When we find ourselves in a difficult situation, how often do our words start spewing complaint? You know, I'm sure that's exactly where the first readers of this letter of James found themselves as they huddled around that dim candlelight to read James's words, to hear it said out loud. They would have heard someone read this from James 3, starting in verse 5. "So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell." Imagine hearing that as James's first reader, how deep that would have hit. "Every species of beast, bird, reptile, sea creature, they can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species, but no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more salt water can yield fresh." I mean, surely those words, It not only hit heavy for us, but they hit heavy in the hearts of those early Christians. Because there they would have sat, far from home. And far from home, I'm sure they gathered together to praise God, to encourage one another, to lift each other up in the calling God had given them. Far from home, maybe they also gathered to complain about all their struggles, maybe even to speak evil of their new neighbors. Blessing God in one side of their mouth, and cursing those made in the likeness of God out of the corner of the other. How often do we find ourselves sitting in the same room? You know, one of the main areas I enjoy researching is the field of communication. I just love all kinds of research about how we best communicate as humans. Preaching, leadership, relationships of all kinds, nearly every area of our life involves communication. There's this one theory of communication that's so widely accepted, it's practically considered fact. The theory says quite simply this idea: words can literally create meaning. Now, I've already said the same idea a different way earlier in the sermon. Words have a world-making potential. They create meaning. In fact, the book of Proverbs, it says the same idea in a way that might even be more familiar to us. Proverbs 18:21 says this: "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit." Death and life are in the power of the tongue. In one particular study, I found absolutely fascinating. It explored complaining. You know, every time we complain, our brains make it easier to complain later on. In other words, our brains literally make a shortcut that makes it easier for us to be negative every time we choose to speak a negative thought. Of course, the opposite is also true. When we choose to speak positively, our brains also build shortcuts to positive thought. But here's another thing that the study found. The majority of people complain on average at least once per a minute in every conversation. Once per a minute in every conversation. But that's not even all that the study found out. It also directly linked negativity and complaining to a whole host of health problems: impaired immune system, heightened stress, vulnerability to strokes, a higher probability for dementia, and on and on and on. All linked to complaining and negativity. You know, it's the same truth that the book of Proverbs has been telling us for centuries. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. But also Proverbs 15:4. Gentle word, a gentle tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks the spirit. And once more, Proverbs 16:24. Kind words, pleasant words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul, and health to the body. And that's exactly the same kind of encouragement that the Apostle Paul places right in the middle of this letter. Right in the middle of this letter that explains faith. Right in the middle of this letter that speaks of faith that actually works. He writes a difficult to digest kind of idea at the beginning of the letter. James chapter 1. Verse 26, if any think that they are religious, do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts. Their religion is worthless. You know, it almost feels like an indictment, doesn't it? As if our own faith is drawn into question by the things that I'm saying. We ourselves, we all struggle so much with the taming of the tongue. And even James looks at the taming of the tongue as an impossible task. So where even is our hope? Because on the one hand, we know it's health to our deepest being if we speak only words of life. On one hand, we know that this extremely practical word is part and parcel of the gospel, of good news that literally sets us free from all kinds of pain. And yet on the other hand, we feel ourselves desperately trapped. On the other hand, we feel like slaves to the power of that small muscle in our mouth that turns our whole lives like the rudder of a ship, like the small bit in a horse's mouth. So where even is gospel? It's a good question to ask the Apostle James. Why even try? Maybe is another question. And yet, there is gospel. Because that's not the world. That's not the struggle that God created from the beginning. It's exactly why I start with Genesis chapter 1. You see, the gospel is always a measure of hope, a message of hope that turns our world upside down and back towards healing. The gospel is always that move back towards healing. So what is gospel, Pastor Tim? Well, here is gospel. God came in Jesus Christ when we ourselves could not, as the living Word of God. That is the gospel. Faith in Christ, it can and does give us the same gospel grace-filled power to live a healed life from the inside out. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Word of God. That in Christ we truly can have a new heart that overflows with rivers of living water. That's the way Jesus talks in the Gospel of John. Living water instead of brackish water. Living water instead of that poison of a deadly sting coming straight from our inward being, all because we're made new by grace through faith. See, I'm talking about a faith that truly works in quite practical ways. But I'm also talking about faith. I'm talking about something that goes beyond merely our own fussing and fighting to get things right, to get our mouth back in check. James is right. Not a single one of us on our own can tame the tongue. Not a single one of us can get it right again by ourselves. See, there's the gospel. I know the living Word of God that comes and heals us from the inside out with that living breath of God, that living Word that makes us whole again, that actually gives us hope again. A living Word that truly changes us. That is our faith. A living Word that has world-shaping potential of healing not just our own hearts, but of building God's gospel kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. That's a faith that works. A faith that sets us towards positive growth, towards positive health. And that's the kind of world that God makes possible, makes real, because of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. So friends, in this very practical way, may we embrace the gospel of Jesus Christ. It leads to life. Not only does Scripture tell us that, but there's plenty of studies that say it too. In a very practical way, the gospel leads to life. So may we embrace fully this faith that works. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Friends, we're going to sing one more song together. Have Thine Own Way. How many of us are perfect in our speech? Yeah. I'm not. I was telling the youth not too long ago, this is probably the area in my life that catches me the most. As a preacher, it's the area that catches me the most. So I think part of the invitation to discipleship is not to feel hopeless. I think we often cop out, especially on our tongue, taming the tongue, and say, well, I'm just human. And we claim hopelessness. That's what we claim. The invitation to discipleship is to claim hope, to claim grace, to claim power and freedom. It truly does lead to life. Not our own struggling to get it right, but in every word we say, giving it to Christ. And so this last song, Have Thine Own Way, I think it's a fitting moment of pause and prayer and commitment as we process these words from James. So let's stand together and sing Have Thine Own Way, Lord, 382. Have Thine Own Way, Lord, have Thine Own Way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Savior, today. Wash me just now, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only, always living in me. That's truly the prayer, right? Fill me with your spirit, Lord, till everyone shall see only Christ living in me. May we go from here in that kind of prayer, not just on our lips, but in our heart. May we go from here truly walking in hope and grace and a faith that works. May we go from here challenged to speak words of life in every moment of every day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.